Welcome to Canyon Hills Presbyterian Church. It's good to be with you. My name's Matt Moncrief, and I'm going to be teaching this morning. Lisa's here. She's sitting in the front pew with a big smile on her face. So good morning, Lisa. Good morning, all of you that are here, and good morning, all of you that are with us online. I can't tell you how grateful I am to be here. All this week, I have been out in the desert in Apple Valley. I've been working in the hospital, doing spiritual care for patients, and I've gotten to see the Holy Spirit move in incredible and crazy and wonderful ways. But during that whole time, as I was there, even as I was seeing God move in these people and in myself, it made me think of how much I missed being here with you all. This place is special to me. You all are special to me. And so, whether you are here for the first time or you have been here for a long time, greetings to you and thank you for being with us and being with me this morning. If you're a part of that diaspora online community that we have right now, I just want to remind you and invite you that you can participate in the chat. Talk to our e-liturgists if you have questions or comments or prayer requests. And for those of you that are here this morning, I look forward to shaking your hand on the patio after church. Other than that, I want to just remind you that if you're a kid, that we have Sunday school here and our Sunday school video online. And with that, why don't we begin with a word of prayer? Lord, you guide us to this place. From the far corners of the world, from far places of the heart, you pull us together like threads into a tapestry to create your church, Lord. We ask that you be with us this morning, that your Spirit guide this worship, that it be pleasing to you, that we be reminded that you, God, are the creator and sustainer, life giver and lover of creation. Lord, be with us as we worship. Amen.
Good morning. We are not abandoned, nor without hope. Our God has given us wisdom and vision through His Holy Scriptures, and the Holy Spirit continues to equip us for good works through the sacred word. Please stand and join us for Be Thou My Vision, verses 1 and 2, number 502.
Or by Good morning. Let us enter into our call to worship. We come joyfully to the house of the Lord. We bring our praise and offer our lives to God. This is our gift and our sacrifice, an act of devotion to God. Let us celebrate God's love with our voices and our lives.
Now please join us as we sing On You's Day. People say amen. Don't forget your clapping part at the end.
You're not the only one. We are all the same. You need a mercy to keep the giver and be. and all the people said amen. Whoa, 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 and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit who are torn apart. Blessed are the persecuted and the pure in heart. Blessed are the people hungry for it, for this is the
share with you the confession of sin and assurance of pardon. Our God is forgiving and does not remember our sins. Open your hearts with me as we acknowledge our deeds and misdeeds. God of creation, your words are given to us so we might be reformed, but we are intent on changing others. Your words are offered to us so we might be transformed, but we are focused on conforming to our culture. Your words are spoken to lead us into new life, but we hold our ways tight to our chests. Hear the prayers of our hearts as we silently confess to you. We are forgiven people. May we live as sisters and brothers in Christ, God's children in word and deed, in hope and joy. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Jesus Christ can be.
So this morning, we're talking about the Bible. And so I'm going to read from 2 Timothy chapter 3. And we're in verses 14 through the beginning five verses of chapter 4. It says this: "But as for you, continue in what you've learned and what you've become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you've known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. All Scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the person of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. In the presence of God and of Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I will give you this charge. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, encourage with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their tickling ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myth. But you, keep your head in all situations. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Discharge all the duties of your ministry." Thanks be to God. So today, we're talking about the Bible. No big deal. The Bible's a big verse, but I'm sure we can cover it in one Sunday morning. I hope you brought your lunches and your dinners and are ready to take it outside at 5 o'clock where we'll continue speaking about the Bible. There's so much to say about the Bible, but we're going to try and do it in 15 minutes. Now, at surface value, the Bible's an old, old book, but it's filled with something. It's filled with something. And the reason why we talk about the Bible using this letter from Timothy is because these letters to Timothy are amazing books for understanding in broad brush the reason we have the Bible and what it can give to us. So Paul is giving instructions in 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus to leaders of churches that he has started. He's encouraging them in what they should look out for, what they should be aware of, what they should be teaching, how they should be guiding the flock. But you have to remember, and I want to get this out of the way right at the beginning, that when Paul is speaking about scriptures to these people, he's not speaking about the Bible as we know it. Paul is speaking before the Bible was compiled. Now, Timothy would understand and know some of these scriptures that we have in our Bible. But Paul is speaking about the Word of God. Paul is speaking about the Spirit of God. And so when Paul is referring to scriptures, he's referring to the writings that were being passed around, the letters that were being held and treasured by churches, the wisdom of Peter and James and John. So we apply these words to our Bible, but we need to get that out of the way so we can out the gate avoid some of the more unhelpful things that we can pull out of this passage. For instance, when this passage talks about all scriptures being God-breathed, we usually understand that to mean that our Bible is written by God. And we take a certain amount of assumption from that because God doesn't change and God is perfect. And then we assume that, okay, so that must be this as well. And I'm not saying that it isn't. But Paul was referring to more than just our Bible. Paul was referring to writings and scriptures. And when you think about it, what Paul is saying to us is in some sense more challenging, because what Paul is saying is that the Word of God as breathed by the Spirit of God, is useful. Now, we have our Bible. And that's what we're going to be talking about this morning, because that's a big enough topic. I can't go and talk about everything else that was written from the dawn of time about God. But for Paul, it was all Scripture that was the writings of Jesus that were useful for these things. So let's look at Scripture being God-breathed. Let's see if we can break that down a little bit and understand this concept. So God, as the author of truth, has given us two tools, and they're mentioned here. The first is Scripture, and the second is the breath, the Spirit. So at the outset, Paul is outlining for us that we have two avenues that come together to give us an understanding of God. The first is Scripture, and the second is the Spirit, the breath of God. Remember in creation, God breathes into man's nostrils and they come alive? It's that Spirit of God that comes together with Scripture to give us understanding. This is important, because if I have learned anything at all from treasure hunt movies, it's that it's not enough to just have the map, right? Are you tracking with me here? You have to also have the, whatever it is, the key to decipher the map, right? It's like I was a huge Indiana Jones fan as a kid. I loved Indiana Jones. I loved action and adventure and that treasure hunt. And every time anybody who is a treasure hunter has a map, they need something to decipher it. Either some sort of key, or in Pirates of the Caribbean, it's the compass, right? Because the compass doesn't point north, it points where you need to go. Or you have the you know, the jewel of what's his name that you put on the pole of whoever it is, and at the summer solstice, the light comes through the window, and then it shows you on the map the location of the treasure, right? This is how it works. That's how treasure hunts work, right? You don't just have the map. You have to have the thing that helps you decipher the map, that gets you where you're going. And in the Bible, we have a map that points us to the treasure of faith and hope and a life lived to the fullest. But Paul says that doing all the right things, following the map, without the Spirit, won't get us there. It'll leave us empty and hollow and void. A clanging gong or a crashing cymbal, he calls it. Not the beautiful song that we can all listen to and enjoy. The Spirit of God guides us to the truth within the Word. What this means is that when we read the Word, we must filter it through the Spirit of God, who is love. The Scripture is useful for teaching, but it is not teaching us anything we want to read. It's teaching us that which is in alignment to the Spirit of God. It is teaching us kindness, patience, goodness, and self-control. The Word is useful for rebuke, but it rebukes attitudes which do not align with the Spirit. Those that lack compassion for others. It corrects those who do not recognize the Spirit of God in their fellow person. It trains in righteousness, which is self-control to put the gospel into action in our life. As it says in verse 17, it is useful for these things, teaching, rebuking, correcting, but not so we can judge people or boast in our success of doing them. The Scripture isn't leading us to, The Scripture is leading us to live our life differently. And it's not the other way around. We don't lead Scripture. Remember, Peter and Paul disagree about a lot of things. They barely agree on what it takes to be saved. They can only come together on the common ground that it happens through Jesus. They disagree about so much. And yet, when Paul comes to Peter's church, he is welcomed warmly. Peter invites him in and asks him to explain to him what he's teaching. He listens. Peter listens to Paul. And after Paul has finished his explanation, the apostle that sat next to Jesus doesn't say, "No, Paul, you're wrong. Here, let me tell you how it really was." Peter says, Okay, we can be brothers. We can both worship God. Peter wasn't insisting that Paul become like Peter. It was enough that Peter could see in Paul the Spirit of God moving. It was undeniable in Paul that the Spirit of God was moving. And Peter had some qualms with what he was saying. He wasn't sure Paul's theology was maybe right on. But when Peter saw the Spirit of God, they left in fellowship with one another. One of the greatest ways that we have fallen short of the word of the Bible in our life is that we have withheld compassion like that from one another. This often stems from the assumption that the opposite of judging is not judging. It's not. The opposite of judgment is compassion. Timothy Engle, now he wrote a book called I Am Here. And in the book, he has this quote. And it says this: "The moment we assume someone's choices have led to their situation in life, we have judged them and compassion is dead. No matter what we say or do, if we have judged at the outset, we have lost the ability to communicate the gospel to them." A friend of mine says it like this: "Love is the quality of attention you give to somebody." If we're very confident we have the right theology, but we do not have that spirit of love and compassion that views one another in the same regard as the Jesus Christ that we call ourselves after, then we don't have right theology. Because right theology will always lead to those things. Right theology will always lead to love and compassion, because that's who God is. The Bible's truth, therefore, is that which hones our understanding of our ethical responsibilities in the world as representatives of Jesus Christ, as representatives of the kingdom of God. That's so important. I'm going to say it again. The Word of God, the truth in the Bible, is that which hones our understanding of our ethical responsibilities in and to the world as representatives of Jesus Christ. Out the gate, our aim in studying the Bible is not to accumulate knowledge. It's to better orient our life after the same way that Jesus lived his. Nothing in the Bible can be understood aside from how it is meant to be applied in our life. Everything in the Bible demands something from our heart, some response. Even every truth of theology is also a practical truth for our life. And I want to just take a quick second and explain what I mean by that. I'll use the idea of providence. Because providence is a big deal for us. We like providence in the Presbyterian Church. And Lisa's bobbing her head. She knows. We like providence, right? Providence says God is going to take care of us. God is going to watch over us. God knows, right? God understands what he's doing in the world. We put a lot of our chips onto providence. But see, in the Bible, we see people responding to providence in a way that orients them towards their ethical responsibilities to people in the world as a representative of God's providence. And so in the Bible, we have people that go out and they sell their property. They sell their possessions. They give away everything they have because they're so confident that even when they have nothing, God's providence will carry them through. God's providence isn't just about saying, oh, I had a rough day, like the Lord knows the plans I have for you, you know, plans to prosper you, not to harm you. It's more than that. It's not just a safety blanket for when we're feeling bad. People were radically responding to providence by saying, okay, I believe that God's providence is real, so I'm going to rely on it in my life. I'm going to act and show you in the world that God's providence is real by doing something that is unexplainable. If I came to you today and said, all right, everybody, we're going to be all selling our houses today, selling all of our cars, and we're just going to live by God's providence, like, you would look at me like I was crazy. But this wasn't something abstract. This is what people in the church did to live out the theology, the things that they believed in. Which brings us to the second important point regarding the Bible this morning. In the latter half, it says there will come a time when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they'll gather around them a great number of teachers to say what tickles their ears. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myth. It's such a funny way to phrase it, right? I don't think I've ever had anybody tickle my ear. But we know what it means, right? We understand what Paul is saying, right? We understand how we are drawn to things that line up with what we want to believe. And this week, as I was at my CPE, actually there was somebody that was saying, I was talking to, and they said, a good preacher isn't the one that tells you what you want to hear, but the one that makes you feel like you need to shape up. And that made me think of this passage, right? So often, we seek after the things that are what we want to hear. Because when we hear what we want to hear in relationship with God and the gospel and truth, we grab onto it and say, there it is. I found somebody that's telling me what I want to hear. But there's two types of tickling. It sounds weird coming out. I'm sorry. It sounds weird saying it on this mic. There's two types of tickling, everybody. Don't tickle your neighbor. We don't need to do that. The first type of teaching that tickles our ears is that what we do doesn't matter, right? This is the myth that has tickled human ears from the very beginning. This is the myth that the snake in the garden uses, right? Surely that's not right, right? It doesn't matter what you do. It doesn't matter if you do. That idea of what we do doesn't matter. That we can have all of the fame, all of the fortune, all of the power. We can have all the things that our heart desires and yet somehow still also be completely right with God. You know, some churches even go as far as to say that God wants you to have those things. That God is just waiting to pour those things on you because that's what God wants. God wants you to have all those things. And that sounds good. But it sounds good because it's tickling our ears. It sounds good because it's not true. And if you have parents like mine, they've told you that if something sounds too good to be true, it's probably not, right? It's wholly insufficient to believe somehow that we can, that what we do doesn't matter. That God doesn't care about how we live our life. God does care how we live our life. God cares that when we say, I am a Christian, that we're not dragging the name of Christ through the mud with our actions. God cares about what we do. God cares about our ethical responsibility to the world that we have as the people of God. But there's also a second type of teaching that can tickle our ears sometimes. And this one can lead to an equally treacherous place. It's the myth that if we do the right things, then we're good. It's the myth that Paul actually spends the majority of his letters arguing against. Because it's so much harder to identify. It's so much harder to point out. The myth is that the things you do are more important than how your heart values other people. Going back to the providence example, if we gave away everything we had and we lift others up, but we still look at them and don't love them like Jesus loved them, we've still failed in following the word and the spirit of the Bible. Now, I'm going to look at another verse here. John, in 1 John, helps us find the sweet spot, the middle ground. John in 1 John says this, "This is the message we've heard from him and announced to you, that God is light, and in God there is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with God, and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and we don't practice truth. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us." You hear that? If we have fellowship with God and yet walk in darkness, if our spirit and our actions don't line up, then that's not kind of okay, whatever. It means that we're lying. It means that we're lying about one thing or the other. We don't practice truth. That's the first ear-tickling myth. But let's be incredibly clear. Walking in darkness is not about being sinful or wrong. That's why we need verse 8. Sinning is part of walking in the light, ironically as it might seem. Walking in the light isn't about doing the right thing all the time and then becoming righteous on our own strength. Walking in the light is about taking seriously our ethical responsibility to others as representatives of the kingdom of God. That's what the Bible is about. The Bible isn't here to tickle our ears or to whisper sweet nothings into our life. It's here to remind us of the word and spirit of God that are on this earth to change it and to transform it and to renew it and to pull it out of darkness and into the light. And it's our responsibilities as the people that believe in it to be the agents of that. We have that ethical responsibility. The Bible is here to reveal the darkness in us. To reveal the darkness in us so we can flee from it. Or we can flee to something that makes our ears feel tickled. But if we do, there will be nothing there. The Bible is there to show us how to walk in the light, sinners and imperfect, failing step by step, but full of the Spirit. All of those myths are mirages. They promise things they can't deliver. They promise a hope that isn't there, a fellowship that can't exist, because they end up in a spirit that is closed to our fellow human beings, that's closed to love and care and compassion. Our verse for today ends with Paul saying, "But you keep your head in all situations. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Discharge all the duties of your ministry." And that's the final key to understanding what the Bible is. It's about what it leads you to do. Each and every one of us is commissioned by Jesus Christ as a representative of the kingdom of God in the world. And our first duty is to share that hope and faith with each other. To step out and live our life in such a way that we endure hardship, that we keep our head instead of lose it, and we discharge the duties of our commissioned state as followers of Jesus. There's no such thing as a Christian who doesn't share Christ. But that doesn't mean that we have to go to door to door. That doesn't mean that we need to stand on a street corner. Living ethically, according to the gospel, according to the word of God, is and of itself sharing Christ. Because it's so contrary to the way that the world works and operates, you will share Christ without saying a word. Your spirit will share Christ as a natural outpouring of the Word and the Spirit of God in our life. That moment that we put that label Christian on us, the moment we say, okay, Jesus, I have no clue what I'm doing, but you know who you are. And I am going to be as close to that as I can be until my life is changed. It's saying, I'm willing to give it a go. The Bible is not a legalistic law of what to do or not to do. It's an outline of how we are to love each other, of how we are to treat each other, of how we are to move and live and act and be in this world. We are to take care of this planet. We are to respect people of authority. We are to add difficulty to the lives of no one. We are to sacrifice ourselves for the benefit of others without any condition, just as Jesus sacrificed himself for us without condition. We are to show kindness and love to our enemies and be peacemakers. We're to be patient in suffering when we're living according to the breathed scriptures of God. All of these things become overlapped. They become one. They stop being disjointed where I have fellowship over here and Bible study over here and evangelism over here and mission work over here. They all become one because the Spirit of God in us, through the Word of God that we read, makes us become and embody those things. Because each and every one of us is responsible for them in the world. So how do we know we're doing a good job at it? How do we know we're succeeding, right? There has to be something that lets us know, okay, are we doing good? Are we doing bad? And I want to finish with this. Because Paul is a genius here. Paul's an absolute genius. Paul realizes that Timothy, just like us, is going to be a terrible judge of his own character. We give ourselves a lot of leeway. I think I'm a pretty good guy. So we're going to naturally give ourselves a lot of leeway. But Paul knows that. So Paul says to Timothy, you will know you are succeeding when you walk and no one has anything bad to say about you. When you live in such a way that nobody, even the people that are desperate to find fault with you, can't find fault. When you live at peace with all people. When your kindness is shown to everybody. When you live beyond reproach so that no one has any complaint to bring against you. And Paul says that if somebody's bringing a complaint against you, don't bristle with pride. Recognize it as the voice of God reminding you of what you are called to, and correct yourself. We're bad judges of our own character, but we can listen to the people around us, and we can see in our own life. I don't want us to be people that allow the Word of God to be something that tickle our ears. I want us to follow the truth and the hope and the life that's found in the Bible, not spend our lives chasing after mirages. The Bible teaches that which is true. The Bible is the Word of God. And the Spirit of God helps us to understand it. The Bible, though, is meaningless until we live it out. We are the ones that give meaning to the Bible. Because the people that need the Word of God will never pick it up and read it on their own. They're going to read it in our life. What we do reflects on what the Bible says. How we act and how we love and how we care tells the people in a suffering and broken world whether there is life in this book or whether it's just another mirage. And so we bring those two things, the theological and the ethical, the word and the spirit, we bring them together in us. And God helps us do it. God doesn't tickle us. God gives us truth. Amen.
Well, I'll use my outdoor voice then. Now is the time in our service for us to come together as a people of God in support. If you have joys or concerns, if you're here in person, please get them to an usher. If you're on our live stream, then communicate with our e-liturgists, and they will get them to Jody so that we can all share in support. Thank you. Cass? Okay.
All right.
Roger.
Oh, here it's on. One, two.
Hello. Woo. Just in time.
Hey. Let there be light.
Just in the nick of time.
All right.
One, two.
Have angels that dance around your shoulders, 'cause at times in life you need a helping hand. Oh, my baby, when you're praying, leave your burdens by my door. You have Jesus standing by your bedside to keep you calm keep you safe away from harm. Worry not, my daughters. Worry not, my sons. Shine when life don't seem worth living.
Come to Jesus and hold you.
Demons. I have come with the life to set you free.
Worry not, my daughters. Worry not, my sons. Shine when life don't seem worth living. Come to Jesus, let him hold you. Here in heaven we will wait for your arrival. Here in heaven you will finally understand. Here in heaven we will wait for your arrival. Here in heaven you will finally understand. Jesus, let him hold you in his arms.
Come to Jesus, let him hold you in his arms.
Beautiful. And now let us join together as we affirm our faith. We have faith. We have very good news to share. It was there, always there, there at the beginning. It is always there and will forever be there. It has been seen with human eyes, heard with mortal ears, felt with our human hands. This is not for solo performers, for through this word of life, we have entered a new community, which through the Spirit we share with the Father and the Son. This is our faith. Of this we speak and write. For this we pray and serve. With this we will live and die. It does not ever get better than this. No wonder our joy is complete. And as we share our prayers of the community, I ask that that you respond with praise be to God. Thank you. How soon I forget. Sorry. Silliness. Lord, hear our prayer. Well, we're starting with a few joys.
That could be
yes. For weddings, for the newlyweds, Andrew and Andy Grant, who were married yesterday, congratulations to the whole Grant clan. Lord, hear our prayer. And we added a couple of joys, which we're so happy about. For Carrie Lawson, she reports that Casey, whom we have been praying for, is recovering well. Lord, hear our prayer. For Matt's grandma, Barbara, who is visiting with us today, and yesterday was her 87th birthday. Lord, hear our prayer. And as we move to our concerns, we pray for the tragic collapse of the condos in Surfside, Florida, and for all the families who have lost their loved ones and are still waiting with hope for survivors, for the rescue workers who are called to do work that is unimaginable. Lord, hear our prayer. Continued prayers for Dennis and Judy Sepulveda. Judy is now at home with hospice support and as usual, is meeting every challenge with grace and gratitude. Lord, hear our prayer. For a friend of Ken Dyla who is undergoing surgery for mouth cancer. Lord, hear our prayer. For Susie McCarsky's brother Ed, who suffered a heart attack while vacationing in Lake Tahoe. Lord, hear our prayer. For Lisa Smith's sister's stepfather, Neil Schmidt, who is experiencing great pain from stress fractures in his back and pelvis. Prayers also for her sister Tricia, who is the main caregiver. Lord, hear our prayer. And for a dear friend of our family, the O'Donnell family, Eric McTernan, who has suffered a stroke this week and is beginning his recovery journey. Lord, hear our prayer. And now, let us together bow our heads. Dear Lord, we come to you with gratitude and humility as we raise our burdens, our grief, our concerns over health issues and life's difficult moments for ourselves, our family and friends, and our greater community. We thank you for being there for us always to ease our pain and making sure that we know that we are never alone. We also celebrate so many of life's joys, Lord, and thank you for all the gifts that you give us in this precious life each and every day, our weddings, births, graduations, and so much more. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we thank you for Matt's message about your word today. When we stray and drift from you, the gentle reminders to turn to you and to your guiding word help us to recalibrate and get back to the place where we stand on solid ground in our faith, and we own our transformative responsibility in our relationship with you. Let us be continually reminded of our committed faith journey as we join together in the prayer your son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I usually don't get to do the announcement, so I was just sitting there reveling in Jody's prayer. Thank you for leading that. And then I was like, oh, announcements. Welcome, church. Good morning. So glad that we could be with one another. I was at the Grant wedding, and so that's why this morning I was just glad to be able to just sit among you and relax after a busy, busy weekend. But we want to remind those of you who may be new with us today, if you're here present with us or joining us online for your first time, we have a little I'm new button on our website and, of course, on our patio. We would love to meet you. We want to remind everyone this morning that this evening at 5 o'clock, even if you are here right now today, it's okay. You can worship twice in one day. Yes, it's true. We have our summer worship outdoor service backed by popular demand at 5 o'clock right out here. But as Matt talked about how sometimes we have these separated parts of our lives, right? We have worship and we have fellowship and we have mission and this. We're doing it all together tonight at 5 o'clock. We have our worship service. We have some fellowship things. We're going to have some game booths for the kids and the adults. We have a mission project that we get to work on together. With for our shower ministry. So if you have some snack foods that are at home and you want to bring those with you, we would love to receive those because we're going to be making some care bags for the clients of the shower ministry that we work with out in Garden Grove. So you can come worship with us. You can do some mission work with us. You can have some fun. We're going to have cornhole, giant Jenga. Oh, yeah, we're pulling it all out for tonight. So we would love to have you join us for that worship service tonight. And again, it's okay. There's not a maximum number of times you can worship in one day. Okay, so. Also, I'm very excited about 4th of July this year. It does land on a Sunday this year, but our community is doing a lot of events, and one of those is the parade. So if you have not seen or been in the parade before, we invite you to join us because we'll be in the parade. Representing our church out there. We've already got a couple classic cars that are ready to be our front end and rear end of our group. But if you want to walk in the parade, scooter in the parade, rollerblade maybe, I don't know, that seems dangerous to me. We'd love to have you join us, strollers, bring it on. We also, I hope they're going to be here by the 4th, have new church t-shirts being designed for us and printed. On the front, I thought I brought an example of here, but on the front, we'll have our logo. On the back, it says, Love Thy Neighborhood, and with a little cityscape on it, so kind of represents who we are, and we will have those shirts for you to wear at the parade. We also, if you want to purchase those to just have in the community, we'll have plenty of them for people to be able to pick up beginning next weekend. So if you want to be in the parade, sign up online. And that would be great. Home groups begin the week of July 12th. There'll be an in-person home group led by Jana Kidd on Mondays, and then a virtual one led by James Farrow on Thursdays. So if you want to hop into a home group, and I'm telling you, I always get fantastic reports about our home groups, I would encourage you to get involved in one or the other. Community prayers. One of the prayers that we had, Ken Dyla used our community prayer line this week, asking prayers for his friend. If you have prayers during the week that come to you, you can just email us at prayers@canyonhillspc.org, and we will include those prayers during the week in our meetings that we have and then also on Sunday mornings. So you can check our website as well for other ways to get involved, and our website also has a handy way for you to give financially, because there's a lot of ways that we give to this church, our time, our talents, and sometimes our treasures, and all of those things enable us to be able to do the work that we really want to be doing out into the community, supporting those, finding the compassion, learning that compassion, and then translating that out into the community. So we invite you to find all those ways to be involved and active online.
As we part this morning, we do so knowing that the Word of God and the Spirit of God goes with us. They dwell in us. And so this week, as we go, may the Word be a light unto your feet and a lamp unto your path. Amen.
Amen.
May the road I rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face, and the rains fall soft upon your fields. Until we meet again, until we meet again, may God hold you, may God hold you, may God hold you.